Ganang hapon po. Good afternoon to everyone. First and foremost, let me greet our officials for this afternoon. Let me greet Dean Orville Jose Solon, sir. Earlier, me and Dean were talking about reproductive health, and during my stint as mayor, Dean Solon visited us in Valenzuela to observe our family planning policies in the city. Let me also greet Director Jeremy Gustafson. Let me also greet Professor Maha Rabago, Professor. And let me also greet our former DOE Secretary, Zenaida Monsada. Let me also greet another DOE official, Attorney Melvin Matibag. Let me greet Dr. Gilberto Lianto of PIDS. And of course, ito suki ho namin to sa Committee on Energy, Yusek Jesus Posadas. Yusek. Let me also greet our panel of reactors, Dr. Alan Ortiz and Dr. Ronald Mendoza. And let me also introduce to everyone the members of the team of the Committee on Energy. Let me introduce to you our committee director, Attorney Joey Gana, and Attorney Tim Guanzon. Our head of our policy research, Mr. David Yap, and Mr. Nico Borromeo. Yan. Di ko alam kung taga-UP ho yan, sir, but sigurado ko magagaling ho yan. Again, thank you very much for inviting me this afternoon. And today our topic is about declaring energy projects as projects of national significance. And just to follow through what Dean Solon earlier said, I had the same question. No? Ano ba itong projects of national significance? In fact, that was a big question mark in my mind, and I asked my team to research on the legal basis of these projects of national significance. So we had many questions. In fact, this buzzword was being floated around in many of the different events and forums. I think Secretary Alcusi also mentioned this, and yours truly also mentioned this, this term. In fact, this was suggested to me by several former DOE secretary. And we started doing our work, asking questions about ano ba talaga itong projects of national significance. One of the most important questions that we ask ourselves, is this also an emergency power that the Congress delegates or gives the executive branch of our government? Currently, we are talking about the emergency powers for traffic. I don't know if you've read in the papers, but the Senate now is currently debating on granting emergency powers to the Secretary of Transportation, precisely to solve the traffic problems of our country. So we ask ourselves, is this the same emergency powers? Kung merong problema, if something triggers a problem, then we call on and declare a project as projects of national significance. If that is the case, what is the difference between projects of national significance and emergency powers? We also ask ourselves, what are the scope? Is this limited to the generating side of the power industry? Or do we include the transmission and distribution side of the power industry? This is also a very important question, because even though you keep on building generating companies or gencos, without transmission and distribution, you cannot bring that power all the way to the household level. So this is a very important question to ask. Do we include the whole caboodle of the power sector in these projects of national significance? And then what is the basis? Do we use the Philippine Energy Plan as a basis, or do we delegate and give that authority to the Department of Energy? No? Set some levels of decision-making points, and if we hit those, then we declare energy projects as projects of national significance. And this is also a very important question to ask ourselves, no? Since we are mandated to create the Philippine Energy Plan, what if we don't need those, we don't meet those plans? What if there is a big earthquake that happened and we don't put up the necessary power plants that will supply us in the next 5-10 years? So what will be our basis? What will be the triggering points to declare energy projects as projects of national significance? Then again, who will declare? Do we give that authority solely to the Secretary of Energy? Or do we include the NEDA as a guiding institution or a certain level of check and balance for declaring projects as projects of national significance? So it's very important also to identify the personalities and the institutions that will declare this type of process. And the most important is really check and balance. No? We have to make sure that when you declare energy projects as projects of national significance, there's also a level of check and balance that will affirm, no, that really need this declaration. We have to watch out for abuses. We have to watch out for conflict of interest. We have to watch out for vested interest. So it's important to have the mechanism that will enforce check and balances within that declaration. So we did our own homework, and to be honest about it, the first thing that came to our research is a communication by the NEDA. I think this was dated last year, no? February of 2016. Basically, sinasabi ng NEDA, wala naman pong animal na projects of national significance. There's no legal jurisprudence that created, no, what we call projects of national significance. And there's no history, there's no law that created this. There's so, in effect, there's no such animal as projects of national significance. And this was very clear from the communication that NEDA gave us during our research. But again, no, we researched some more and we looked at this, several applications of these projects of national significance. One of the most interesting applications is in a BOT process or a PPP process. And we identified about three bills filed, I think filed this Senate and also during the past Senate. In one of the provisions there, the bills declared BOT projects as projects of national significance. And I will discuss later what are the accompanying privileges, you know, when these bills declare a project of national significance. But these bills didn't limit to energy projects. No? It actually opened up to more other projects. Projects such as toll roads, projects such as sewage, you know, waste disposal system. But it also focused on inter-jurisdictional projects, such as, let's say, toll roads. No? When you build a toll road, it's not limited to one province. It will crisscross several provinces. And this is where this proposal, through this bill, came about, no? To solve inter-jurisdictional problems. A very interesting bill was filed. This is actually filed by the former Committee Chair on Energy in the House of Representatives. It's actually very specific, no? Declaring energy projects as projects of national significance. But if you compile all of these bills, no? It has four salient features. No? Number one, it gives tax exemptions, especially real estate. Number two, it gives tax incentives. Actually, the tax incentives is through simplification of local taxes. Dahil, you know, if you build, for example, a toll road or a transmission line, each LGU will have a different tax rate. So if, for example, you crisscross, your transmission line will crisscross 20 different municipalities, you will have to pay 20 different local government taxes or local government assessments. So basically, the bill just said, lahat kayo pare-pareho na. No? So if you have inter-jurisdictional projects such as toll roads, pare-pareho na yung babayaran nyo sa the LGUs. One of the most salient features of all of these bills, all of these proposed bills, is actually fighting red tape. All of them contain provisions on streamlining, issuing permits as fast as possible, and fighting red tape. But another key feature is actually that one of the bills proposed is TRO exemptions. And this is actually quite an interesting proposal because I've heard so many horror stories about TROs, about TROs for sale, about TROs being used to harass the winning bidder. I remember one time there's this project, no? It's a competitive bidding, and the bidder that lost the project started filing cases on the project itself. No? I think it took almost 10 years before the project actually was constructed and actually broke ground. Imagine 10 years was delayed because a losing bidder, obviously sore loser siya, naganap siya ng butas doon, nag-file siya ng mga cases, na-delay yung project. But when this type of project gets delayed, no, ang kawawa ho dito si Juan de la Cruz. It's not actually the winner or the loser. It's Juan de la Cruz that loses in this type of situation. So one of the proponents of the bills I mentioned earlier introduced a TRO exemption. Only the Supreme Court can actually file a TRO to stop the project. No? But you have to go through a very difficult process of defending and justifying your TRO. One of the discussions in the declaration of projects of national significance came about actually in the Pandakan issue. No? And we're very fortunate that former Secretary Monsada is here. She actually explained this to me in detail, no? In great detail, when I met her a few weeks ago. Basically, no, you have a project, let's say a huge oil depot that supplies the entire Metro Manila. And then all of a sudden, sabi ng Manila, ah, hindi na pwede dito in Divo. We will change our land use. So from industrial 3, we will change it now to commercial 1. Therefore, bawal na kayo dito. So what will happen to the depot? There's nowhere, no, within Metro Manila that you can relocate the depot. But in that effect, the effect of that actually is an effect to all of us, the consumers. Prices will go up. We will now have difficulty in bringing oil to our metropolitan area. But let's apply this to power generation companies. Just imagine if there's a, no, there's a, in Davao, there's a new power plant there, no? I think it's Thermasouth, which is about almost 400 megawatts. And that supplies a huge chunk of Mindanao's power. What if one day Davao will say, bawal na yung power plant, no? Gagawin na naming residential area yan. So the entire Mindanao now will have problems with their electricity. Actually, what Secretary Monsada said, advised us and told us that we can actually apply, you know, and declare this type of projects as projects of national significance to insulate, you know, this type of mega projects or big ticket projects from changes in the local dynamics. Whether it's political, it's policy, or it's land use, you insulate those projects because those projects will have tremendous impact, whether positive or negative, to our country and to the locality. Recently, the Department of Energy shared with us their draft executive order containing the definition of projects of national significance. I don't know, Yusek, kung pwede ko na ma-share to, ha? Hindi ako nagpaalam sa inyo, pero si-share ko na rin, no choice na kayo, eh. No? Basically, in that executive order, a major energy project is defined, a major energy project identified and endorsed by DOE and is consonance with the Philippine Energy Plan. So meaning, if the project is inside or contained within the Philippine Energy Plan, then the DOE can declare these projects as projects of national significance. And there are several attributes, you know, to become a project of projects of national significance. Let me just point out the first bar, no? One of the most important attributes is you should have a capital investment of 3.5 billion pesos before you can be considered as projects of national significance. So kasama siya, dapat 3.5 billion pesos yung capital expenditures mo. And I have some thoughts about this, no? Because right now, with the deregulation of our power industry, we are now seeing a lot of disruptors coming in the power generation. Ano ito yung mga disruptors na tawag natin? These are the small solar power plants, no? 10 megawatts, 20 megawatts that come into the different parts of the country. Run off river, no? That is being constructed in some remote places. Even diesel-powered power plants, no? In the SPAG areas. And all of these are below 3.5 billion pesos in terms of investments. So, kung itong mga maliliit na solar power plants, no, will be constructed, then hindi sila pwedeng ma-declare as projects of energy projects as projects of national significance because they will not be in compliant with what the executive order stated. At the same time, in the executive order, this is actually one of the most important features of the executive order. The DOE secretary now can issue environmental compliance certificate. And we all know this ECC actually is a very controversial process, no? In the whole process of constructing a power plant. It takes years before you can get your ECC. And sometimes there's also disconnect, no? Between the Department of Environment, which issues the ECCs, and also the Department of Energy, which is actually the end user of the power plant. So in the proposal, the Secretary of Energy will now be empowered to issue ECCs only for energy projects, no? Power plants, transmission projects. And this is actually a good feature of the executive order. I remember during our consultation, when you apply for a power plant, or a permit to build a power plant, you have to wait for the other permits to get approved before your other permits get approved. No? And because of that process, normally it takes 4 years, 1,200 days to get your permits approved. So this feature is quite good because basically what it says, hindi mo na kailangan antayin yung iba pang permit para ma-approve. You can simultaneously apply and all of those permits will be simultaneously approved. You don't have to wait for the other permits to be approved. In the executive order, it also contains that within 30 days, all the permits should come out. Pag hindi lumabas in 30 days, your application is deemed approved. No? So the other agencies will now be pressured to approve the application permits within 30 days' time. So having said that, having explained all of this, we came to a conclusion that for energy projects, we actually need to solve the red tape issue in building the power plant. We came to a conclusion that the problems of bringing in new supply actually comes from the long process of getting your permits approved and also the red tape in that process. I remember when we were consulting a lot of the energy generators, they told me that it takes 4 years, no? Just to get your permits approved and another 2 years to build your power plant. So 6 years from start to end, no? From permitting all the way from generating power. And one of the things that we were thinking paano na yung mga maliliit na mga energy disruptors like solar, runoff river, and the SPUG areas? Because in the DOE proposal, hindi sila masasama doon. So meaning they have to go through the normal process of 4 years getting their permits and all the red tape. So what we decided is to attack the problem. And the problem really is red tape, no? The bureaucratic process that everyone has to go through in order to put up the supply or the power supply here in our country. And that's why we actually proposed what we call the virtual one-stop shop. No? And in the past few months, we had 2 hearings and 1 technical working group. Basically, this proposal will address the common problems of all of the power generation proponents. And if you ask any of the power generation proponents, they will say, we have 3 major problems, no? In putting a power plant. Red tape, the local government units, and indigenous peoples, the IP. This bill is very simple. No? The bill will now create a virtual one-stop shop. No? The government will now create the framework to create that software. And all of the departments will now link to that software. So everyone will be linked. And everyone will now know exactly where those paperwork will have to go through. I remember one time talking to a friend of mine who applied for a solar power plant. And nagsubmit siya ng paper, no? In one of the agencies. And almost 2 months, he was asking, bakit yung paper ko hindi lumalakad? So he went to that office, and he went to that person who he gave his application to. Ang sagot sa kanya, sir, kaya 2 months na ho hindi lumalakad yung paper nyo dahil nag-awul po yung messenger ho namin. No? So walang maglilipat ng papel nyo from first floor to the second floor. No? So just imagine, I think I've heard so many horror stories about applications, not only in power plants, no, but virtually in every single process in the government. Whether you're paying your personal income tax or getting your driver's license, a lot of horror stories. But power is a special case because if we don't get our power plants online on time, wala tayong kuryente lahat. No? So it's important to make sure that timetables are met. And our proposal is to come up with a virtual one-stop shop because you cannot cut red tape without using technology. It's impossible. If you want to cut red tape, you have to use technology. If not, no, it's the same people moving paper to paper, desk to desk, office to office. Gumawa tayo ng batas, but it's the same process. No? The salient features of this bill is, again, it's an online system. It will be paperless. In fact, this concept is nothing new. The USA already funded the EVOS in the Department of Energy, but solely for renewable project. So with that platform, we are now proposing to expand it to all forms of energy, no? But limited to GenCos muna. No? We didn't extend to transmission or we didn't extend to distribution. This is limited to generation because our problem now is getting supply online on time. So we focused on the generation projects. In the initial phase, we will form a technical working group. Medyo maraming agency ho yan. Pero I was telling DOE this is necessary to get all the comments, everyone's views. Because in government, usong-uso po yung turuan eh. Pag hindi mo in-invite yung isa, no, magtatampo pa sa'yo, they will not cooperate, then the whole system will fail. No? So it's very important that in the beginning phase, in the initial phase, we have to invite all the stakeholders, give their comments. But the unique feature here is it will be under the office of the president para may political muscle. No? Kung hindi yung makikinig, tanggal sa trabaho. We consulted heavily the local government units because, like I mentioned earlier, the local government units were part of the problem instead of the solution. And being a former mayor, I understood, no, the process in the local government. And we managed to wrestle with the local government units na instead of three levels, no? Barangay, municipal, and provincial, let's do it in one level, no? In the provincial level, because everything will end up in the provincial level anyways, no? If inapprove ni kapitan, aakyat sa municipal. Pag inapprove ni mayor, aakyat rin kay governor. E di diretso na ho natin kay governor. Pwede naman yun, no? And they all agreed na pwede naman, no? And we also managed to negotiate with them that let's peg a number, and that's 45 days. So instead of now 6 months or maybe uncertain time frame, in 45 days, your necessary permits in all levels of the local government will come out. And another feature of this bill, we also managed to wrestle talaga dahil we had to really wrestle with them, no? That all necessary permits from the NCIP should come out within 30 days. This is actually another big bottleneck, no? If you talk to hydropower plants, because normally the hydropower plants will be located up in the mountains or up in the stream, and normally you have to communicate and you have to deal with the local indigenous peoples in that area. But dealing with them also takes a lot of time and uncertainty, and that's the problem with energy projects. We cannot have uncertainty. No? Pag sinabi natin, the plant will come out online in 3 years, it has to be 3 years. It cannot be four, it cannot be five, because everything is interconnected in the power industry. If one is delayed, then we will not have electricity. So after the technical working group, we managed to convince them, so far, that in 30 days, all of the necessary permits from NCIP will come out. So this is also simultaneous. We managed to tell these two entities that we don't have to wait for DOE to release everything. Simultaneous na mag-a-apply yung mga power plants. So simultaneous, lalabas yung mga permits nila. I guess the most important feature of this bill is really political will and penalties. No? Even though you have a fantastic bill, no, you have everything there, but if you don't have the administrative penalties, no, or sanctions, nothing will happen. No? It's important there's accountability, and there's important that sanctions are very clear. So in the bill, we itemized the different penalties that government employees might face if they don't cooperate or they deliberately sabotage the system. So political will is embedded in this bill. Then of course, one of the most important feature also is the budget, diba? Because we are now putting up a new system. We are now building a virtual one-stop shop. So we allocated initially 15 million pesos to build this system. From our discussions with DOE and the other stakeholders, especially the ones that build the EVOS, this amount is about right, no? To cascade it to all of the different departments in government. Well, anyways, again, thank you very much for inviting me. Just to recap, no? In our view and research, I actually subscribe to what Dean Solon said, no? That all projects, whether you're 1 megawatt or you're 1,000 megawatt, is deemed as national importance. No? Because all of these projects will contribute to the entire supply capacity of our country. That's why we decided that instead of having trigger points, no? Whether force majeure, whether fortuitous event, it's better to apply, no? Fighting red tape to all capacity levels and to all technologies. That's why we pushed for this virtual one-stop shop, so all of the different proponents in energy generation will enjoy smooth, on time, and certainty in their application for permits and licenses. Again, thank you very much for inviting me. Magandang hapon po.